I would like to introduce our lead guide, Barbara Bates. Thank you.
Well, hello again. I got to get the mojo back. And I don't sit still. And these guys that are live streaming, I'm making their job difficult too. But I started to say my job is difficult today because I'm after lunch. So I have to keep you all awake, and that's never an easy process. And I certainly know how well everybody likes to talk about care planning and how well and how enthusiastic everybody is. But I'm hoping that by the end of this that you will have some of the passion that I have for care planning. They told us that they had no long bios, but I at least want to tell you who I am. And although I do have an MSN next to my name, okay, and I'm also a nurse executive that's certified, and I teach MDS and do all that stuff, I have been a certified nurse's aide. I have been an LPN. I have been an RN that's done multiple floor jobs, and I worked, you know, different management and administrative roles. I started my history in a psychiatric center. Not as a patient, but as a, my husband thinks about committing me every now and then. I worked psychogeriatrics, and that was back in the day when, in New York State, folks who had dementia were placed in institutions such as a psychiatric center. So I had to work, I had 12 units at the time of probably 48 patients each that had various types of dementias. And of course, finally, the state woke up and thought, hey, this is not a rehabable disease. So then they started doing the movement of placing folks in nursing homes. And so I did that career for about 25 years. And then I was a director of nursing. I retired for 2 weeks, and then I started doing consulting. So that's me, as far as my credentials. But you know what? I've also been a daughter and a caregiver. My dad was in my nursing home after he had a CVA after a surgery. I've cared for a dying mother as well as several others of my family. So I can say honestly that I've been on both sides of the coin and kind of can talk to why these care plans and why we need to get to know people better. I like my sessions informal. If you have a question, raise your hand. If I get talking too much, my timekeeper will keep me in line. And I want this to be of benefit to you, so I'm hoping you're going to come away with some positive thoughts. Probably not going to teach you anything that's brand new, because care planning has been around forever. But I want to bring some ideas to you to have you think about and be able to take back to your teams. Does that sound like an okay thing? All right. So let's talk about a couple of people who've been probably done a lot of studying with respect to listening. Both actually doctors. And these are just a couple of quotes that I found that I thought were very relevant to what we're going to be talking about and what we're talking about here in this conference. Ralph Nichols says that the most basic of all human needs is the need to understand and to be understood. And the best way to understand people is to listen to them. That makes sense? It does to me. And then Dr. Mayo says, one friend, one person who is truly understanding, who takes the trouble to listen to us as we consider a problem, can change our whole outlook on the world. Think that makes sense to me too. So here are your learning objectives. My learning objective is that you come away with something that's useful to you. So when we talk about elders, okay, this is Miriam's definition. But what we're here for is the fact that this whole process, this whole conference, is about the elder and not necessarily us and our needs. Every once in a while, because I do a lot of consulting throughout the state, I like to remind people about person-centered care. And everybody calls resident-centered care. They all have different definitions to stuff. And the reason I like to go back through this before I actually get into care planning detail is because some of these factors impact how you care plan. So to me, when you really talk about looking at person-centered care, you're talking about a normal life. Does everybody agree with that? Has everybody gone through a major journey of culture change in all your homes? Let me see a show of hands. Do you feel that you've totally converted? Some are just in the beginning stages? Yes? No? Okay. So we're really talking, and you have to decide facility by facility where it is that you're going with your culture change. But some folks may be just starting to look at how we're going to really focus on that elder, might be looking at things as simple as bath routines, you know, folks getting choice about when they get up, when they go to bed, you know, all those things. And what I find when I go out into the homes, I find that the homes are really in various stages. And this actually came from a 2010 Pioneer Network program. And what I find is that somewhere between staff-centered and person-centered is where I find the homes that I visit. So looking at those two definitions, where do you see your homes? Who was somebody that was told me they were totally converted? Do you think you're fully to the point of person-directed?
Oh, yeah.
That's wonderful. Anybody else feel that they're fully person-directed, person-centered directed? Okay, got another one in the back. That's great. Is it an easy process?
Oh, no.
No.
No, it's a challenge every day.
Every day.
And you never get there. Even though you think you're there, then you got to check and make sure that you're there.
Right. Because if you take your eye off of it, what happens?
Oh, no. Yeah.
So this is kind of why I like to review some of this stuff. Because I think sometimes we have to kind of re-energize, just like I said, the reason of coming here for the program. Now, I'm going to ask you a question, or two, or maybe three. Who has teenagers in the room? Anybody? Oh, God, I'm sorry, first of all. Tell me your feelings when they don't listen to you. Who in the back raised their hand that they had a teenage child? Tell me how you feel when you're trying to get your child to understand something and they aren't listening at all. If you didn't hear her, she feels like stabbing herself in the eye. How about anybody else? Frustration. How about anybody else? Anger. Yeah. Now, what about them? What do they feel like when you don't listen to them? Same thing, but times 100. Ooh, that's right. Now, I do qualify because I have a 16-year-old grandson and an almost 13-year-old grandson, and I often tell them I love them very much, but I don't like them. I can't help it. But I figure these pictures are often what you look like. You agree? You know, I can see myself saying, no! I can remember telling my children that. And sometimes the brotherly love kind of thing, when they won't listen to each other, where they're whacking each other and stuff. So why is it when sometimes our residents or our elders or our members, depending on what it is or how we title our folks living in our homes, sometime are expressing themselves not necessarily verbally, why is it that sometimes we're classifying them as inappropriate behavior? Do we do that? Do you think there's maybe ways that we could hear or listen or try to figure out better what's going on here. I'll have you know, okay, of course, following Dr. Powers is a tough act, okay, because I shared with our coordinator that I couldn't get in because the room was full. I went upstairs. I live streamed it, laying down on my bed with my shoes off. It was wonderful. So let's think about some ways to capture voice. We're going to talk about your teams in a minute so that we can kind of get a feel for where it is and how it is that we're connecting with our elders. Some ways that I think about would be to ask. Hello, Michael.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm awesome. Thank you.
You're awesome. And, you know, is there anything that, you know, since you've come into my home, our home, that I could do that maybe could be done better for you?
Yeah, I don't get up till 11.
You don't get up to 11? And would you like to see that change so that you're not being awoken earlier?
The nurse keeps knocking on my door at 8 o'clock in the morning to give me one pill that I could take any time during the day. Can I just get up at 11 and take it then?
I think we could see about doing that for you. We need to be asking them what's important to them. And sometimes we have to cue because they may be not figuring out or understanding what we're talking about, right? So sometimes we have to ask some questions. And then there's that thing called active listening. Hello, Carrie.
Good.
How are you today?
Good, thank you.
Yeah, you know, I'd like to see if there's anything that I could be doing for you. Do you think there's anything that I could do that would be helpful to you?
I'd like some water.
You'd like some water? Okay, I'll see about somebody getting you that. Hi, Carrie.
Hi.
How are you today?
Good.
Good. Things going all right for you?
Not bad.
Can't complain. Is there anything that, you know, I'm working on maybe doing some changes with the unit that would help maybe make your stay here with us any better?
If I could get a pitcher of water so I could get water in my room.
Just give me a minute and I'll get that pitcher for you. There's a difference in how people perceive that we listen to them. If we look at, thank you, woo-hoo! When we really look at those care needs and having it truly based on a want to get up at 11 o'clock versus, you know, it's the nurse's time to pass the pill, to be able to get to lunch at whatever time. Do we have that happening in our homes? So we got to work on ways to changing that. And then certainly looking at ways that we can support their rights. How do you support people's rights in your homes? Who hasn't talked to me? That table right there, one behind the live streamers. What do you do to support your residents' rights?
I advocate for the residents. I'm an ombudsman.
Oh, so we have an I could never say that word right, I apologize. We got one of the good guys who are out there advocating. So if they share a problem, you come in and you look for it, or try to support what's going on and look into it. What about you over here? What do you do at your homes?
Make sure that their dignity is preserved.
Dignity being preserved. How do we do that? Even Dr. Powers mentioned that today.
How do you do it?
Yeah.
Initially, you start by knocking on the door.
Thank you. That's exactly what Dr. Powers brought up. Something as simple as that, sometimes we have to go back to basics. You know, I can remember, you know, we used to not do that. And now it's knock, knock, knock. Nobody answers. Knock, knock, knock. Hello, Mrs. Smith, can I come in? We should be asking. Because I don't think you would show up on my door at my home and just walk in, would you?
No.
No. Probably something would happen to you if you did. My dog would lick you to death. No, Shih Tzu. So we've already talked about that careful listening. How do you teach staff to do careful listening?
Wait for an answer.
Wait for an answer. Give them time, right? We want to give them time to process. Do you think it might be important to ask the elder what their goal is? Why are you laughing? Why are you laughing at me?
Because it's the very basic problem that we have in Long Hill here.
That's right.
Nobody asks the resident what they want.
Right. And do you think that if they're coming into your home, or should be their home, it would be important to get a feel from them as to what they expect of us? Do you think that's important? Yeah.
And you know, I just want to think of that. I constantly have to tell my residents, this is your home.
That's right.
So yes, you can have choices. And you know, the weird thing is that they already know that, you know, no, I don't have a choice. This isn't my home. And I have to reteach them.
Yeah.
They have a house.
But maybe there's a reason that we're having to reteach them. Maybe it's because our staff collectively hasn't made them feel that this is their home. Does anybody disagree with that? We want to talk about those health beliefs. And we want to make sure that those things that we gather, whether it's their goals or their beliefs or their ideas for advanced directives, if it's only kept within a certain few, do you think that does the resident or the elder any good? If your other staff don't know this information, and you're not sharing that information with all the way down, then you're going to have a breakdown. You know, when I want to know something the most about my elder when I was still in a DON position, do you know who I would go and talk with? Who was that? No. The housekeeper. And we often, with particular residents, would ask that housekeeper to come in, certainly with the resident's or the elder's permission, because they felt comfortable with them. They may know their whole life story, because they took the time to do what? Yeah. When they get upset, do you think it might be important, as we do interviews with people, she's laughing at me again, that we might want to be thinking or talking with our, and when I talk about the elder, if the elder can't speak to themselves, I'm automatically thinking family in their stead if I don't say that. But if I want to know what triggers people's buttons, it's kind of helpful if you know it ahead of time. Do you do that when you do interviews and your family's coming in or your elders? Everybody? Good. And when those behaviors do occur, how do you search for triggers? Who hasn't talked to me? Somebody over there. When you have somebody that has a behavior, what do you do to be able to figure out what it is that's causing the behavior? Okay. What else? Anybody else got any ideas? Ask them? Oh, that's novel. I like that. What else? Hang on. Right. You're going to be certainly investigating for, you know, alternate causes. What else?
Mapping.
Mapping. Explain napping to the group.
Environment, every 5 minutes you're getting
Thank you for sharing that. Yes, ma'am.
Now, does that work very well with the person that can't speak?
Yeah, it actually is better and even more important for the people that can't communicate, because it can be something as subtle, like I have Matt, a resident, who from breakfast, you know, was sitting at a table and they kept offering her drinks, but the woman couldn't speak up, say, and all of a sudden you started seeing her being more and more agitated and more restless than I've seen. So when mom was, they kept offering her something to drink, but nobody was taking her to the bathroom.
Bathroom. That'll be me.
Yeah. So you picked up that this person needed to be make sure that they toilet wherever is not good for them. So in the hour is when they're offering food so that she doesn't get agitated.
So how do you collect the information when those behaviors are happening on evening and night shift? Yes, ma'am.
We have
huddles. They have huddles. Does everybody else have huddles? So they're talking about it, and probably the nurse's aides and anybody that works the floor or the household or whatever would be there. But you got to have systems to be able to collect that information from all three shifts, because it doesn't certainly end on just day shift, does it? Yes, ma'am.
Consistent assignments.
And again, that was something else that Dr. Powers underscored a lot this morning. Looking at not only the upsets, what helps calm them down? What are the things that I used to, as a nurse, I used to be a firm believer. Dietary never liked me, but I liked PRN cookies and milk. And I would sit down, it didn't matter what time of the day, it could have been at 3 o'clock in the night, to be able to do my milk and cookies, because that's what I used to do with my grandma. I forgot to tell you when I started, I'm a very self-taught pioneer. This is my first time coming and having the pleasure of spending time with all of you. And I've already learned so much. But some of it just came from the heart, because this is what I was raised to do with our elders, you know? So we're going to go searching for this, and we want to make sure that this information gets captured on those care plans. And we've already talked this. My question to you, is there anything that I haven't thought of or we haven't brought up as a way that you're capturing voice? Oh, let's talk about these old things. Do you train your staff so that they know what's in these regulations? Does everybody do that? It makes me crazy that we're expecting people to work within the regulations but still make change. And it can happen, because I don't know if anybody was at that session yesterday where the surveyor actually stood up and said that a lot of the things that we're talking about can be accomplished, and they are within the regs. When we're talking about care planning and looking, one of the first things under F2, and these are not all inclusive by any means, but under F tag 272, it's observation and communication with the person. That's the prime place that you should be getting the information from. When you're looking under interdisciplinary teams, and we're going to talk about teams in just a minute, making sure that that interdisciplinary team is including the elder and or their families in the planning. When I go out and I look at deficiencies, this is the hot button. It's in the top 10 right now of care plan deficiencies, because people are not including the families and the residents. Oh, we invite them annually. Somebody said quarterly. I have homes that sometimes, like I said, just once a year. If you're planning my care, I want to be there. And I want to be a part of it. But I may not like to come to your silly old meeting that I feel like everybody's just attacking me. Does any of your residents often say, I don't want to come to your meetings? Do you ever have that happen? Do you ever ask why? Or think about why? kind of intimidating sometimes. You going to laugh at me again? Oh, okay. And when we're talking about the goals, I think we already had a little laugh about that. The fact is that it's the resident's goal. It's the resident's care plan. So who ought to be in charge of it? Thank you. And you have to understand, I'm old school. I still use that resident term. So I'm sorry, it's the elder. We're going to talk about care area assessments, but this is another area where deficiencies are starting to pop up because people are not using those care area assessments to really dig and look at the information about the person and using it to build care plans that include the information that the regulation requires. Oops, sorry. That's where that came from. It's just the newest book. And certainly, that's why I put this up there with the blinky light. It's including them, plain and simple. So this is my question to you, because I don't like to do just the talking. I want to know if you think your teams are inter or multidiscipline, because it makes a difference on how your care planning will occur. So, table in the back. Hi. Is your teams inter or multi? Do you have teams? Yes. Nobody wants to say anything. Inter. Why do you think inter? So you have multiple disciplines, okay. So why else? All there for the same purpose, okay. I saw a hand up in the back there. Okay, is your team that way? So they collaborate with each other and the resident or the elder. Okay, who else? Does anybody think their team is multi? Tell me why.
Oftentimes the care plans are written in silos.
Plans are written in silos. Does everybody understand what that means? What written in silos means is that dietary writes their plan for the person. Then we move on to nursing writing their plan for the person. Then we move on to therapeutic rec, then on to rehab, then on to whoever else is on the team. And you can pick up a care plan, and those care plans are often probably 30 pages long, at least those are the ones I find, that often will say the same thing redundantly, but it's just based on discipline. Does anybody have that occur in their facilities now? Hello, is anybody out there? That you do think?
I think that we're really more multidisciplinary than interdisciplinary. Not that we have a goal of being interdisciplinary.
Always, I think that's always. And a lot of times teams will tell me there's some of both because they flip-flop. And enter in a new member, sometimes that'll change the mix. The following is a definition, actually a study that was done by Jessup in 2007. And I bring up multidiscipline first, and you will see that you have all the different disciplines, and they're all working on maybe the same issue, but they may have very different specific goals for the person. The team may meet and they may talk about what's going on with the resident, but they implement their own care plans, i.e. the silos. Oftentimes with multi, resident families are not key. They're not at the top. They're not in charge. And they don't always share the information about goals and what they're doing with the person with each other. So there's kind of a communication breakdown. Not always, but sometimes. And lastly, when you have issues that kind of cause inconsistent caregiving, that's usually when you've got multidisciplinary teams. Oops, my clicker doesn't want to work. Enter, everybody is out there, there's different disciplines, but they assess and they collectively come up with that care plan. And when I say that, that includes the resident and or the family. They work on common goals. Do you think sometimes a village with lots of hands can accomplish more than one single discipline? And with our folks being as complex as they are, don't you think we need the village most often to take care of our folks? That's how I see it. They complement each other, they respect each other, they pull on each other's expertise that they can share with each other. So the teams are empowered. And they really do work to identify those specific residents' needs. Does that make sense? So let me ask that question again. Who still thinks that they're totally interdisciplinary? Give me a show of hands. Oh, I'm coming to her place. I got two. Anybody else? No? So let's talk about, is your team really listening? Each of your folks, even if they work in a silo, which you don't want them to do, are they sharing? I often found when I was working a lot on MDSs that there were times when those, you know, the interviews that have to be conducted, is everybody familiar with what an MDS is? I didn't ask, so sometimes we have family, you know, assisted living, and those folks don't do MDSs. Everybody okay with that term? I used to find that I would get, if I'd send one of my activity aides in to do some of those interviews, I could get more information from the resident because they trusted that person. That activity person is out there doing the pleasurable things, building the trust, taking the time to talk, that the resident would answer the interview questions more honestly than they would with someone else. So that's one thing that you may want to think about, who's doing that process. You sure can.
Hold on. I want to make sure everybody can hear.
Thank you.
You want to check with your survey agency. In our state, that's not allowed. They're very specific about by education and degrees and such, who can...
And where is that written in the RAI manual?
That would be a good question for our state survey agency. Go ahead and give them a call.
Okay, I'd be glad to. Is there a surveyor in the house? Another one. Oh, my goodness. You're going to take that back to those folks, aren't you?
Well, I don't know what state.
Well, we're not telling either.
Ask them to show it in the regulations.
Yeah. You know, and please don't think that I am pushing to do anything adversarial with the survey team, because I work very closely with our New York State team. I'm on a couple of grants that they do. But sometimes, it's sometimes individual biased based on surveyor. And please, if I'm saying anything wrong, folks, please chime in. But I think you have to sometimes do that challenge. Yeah.
The only thing that's required is that an RN sign off on that.
That's right.
It doesn't matter who puts it in.
Yeah, I hear you. And we're not going to go there.
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Is telling them that no, the activity person has to do this section,
yeah.
So-and-so has to do this section, and I'll say, you know, hey, I have nothing to do with that. That's not in the REI manual. That's not in the federal regulations.
Thank you
it's
for sharing
my
that.
Rule.
Thank you.
And sometimes the state regulations
That's true. If you didn't hear her, she said that sometimes the state regulations are more stringent than the federal ones, and that it's going to be whichever is the more stringent that they're going to be followed. That's absolutely, yes.
Of nursing. Ours says that they're not allowed to assess unless they have licensure as an LPN, RN,
right.
or above.
And I'm not talking about assessment. I'm talking about,
if
yeah,
if it's labeled
go ahead.
As an activity assessment, they can argue that with us.
Okay, well, absolutely. I'm talking about the interviews, not the assessment piece. I'm talking the interview pieces. And that isn't necessarily, depending on what it is. I'm not saying I'd have them go in and do every, but it's something to think about. Or if you're worried that you may be crossing a line that maybe not go along with what your survey folks, so why couldn't two of you go in? If you've got somebody that they feel comfortable with, why not? Nobody says that you can't have two. Food for thought, that's all. Are you making sure that your families and your elder are an active part of the team, not just a token when they get invited for a quarterly meeting or a once-a-year meeting? Are your nurses' aides from any of your shifts involved in care planning? Show me hands. How many? Thank you. Because to me, that's so, so important. That we're capturing what they know. And then looking at the team and how they're identifying strengths and how they're identifying the residents' needs, because that's what's needed to build care plans. And what are we doing to support those goals that are those residents' goals? Not the staffs. Very often when I read care plans, I find goals that I can bet most of the residents never came up with. Oh, that wonderful RAI manual tells you all sorts of wonderful things about your care area assessments. And those care area assessments, if they're done well, and they're done by people who know the resident, should be able to siphon out those really important characteristics and strengths that are going on with the resident. And how those strengths and those characteristics kind of interrelate with the functioning of the person are really the key of where you're going with this care plan. And how are you collecting the information? How are you getting the families involved? This is a Barb Bates, pull it together so I can try to make sense of all this stuff that we have to do, kind of a flow thing. The inner part of it is really, of course, certainly in the middle of the circle is always our elder. And when the inner circle is talking about how we're doing care planning, it's really talking about how we identify those issues that are going on with the person, okay? It may be those things that are being triggered from the MDS. It may be those things that we see, because we're responsible for also identifying things that aren't necessarily coming out of the MDS. And then certainly building that care plan based on their needs in looking at strengths. Do you think it might be a more positive way to look at care planning if you're building on somebody's strengths versus always talking to them about, well, you can't do this and you can't do that, and well, you're really not strong enough to do this. But gee, it might be, you know, if we can keep somebody's strength in a particular area, even if it's a matter of walking from the bed to the bathroom, to me, that's the way I want to go. I don't care if I can walk in the hallway, or I don't care if I can walk 50 feet, first of all, because I have my space ability, I couldn't tell you what 50 feet even is. But I do know, when I am in your home, and God help you if I am, I can guarantee that I will make sure that somebody's taking me from that bed taking me to that bathroom so somebody isn't putting me in an incontinent brief. Because that's, you know, I'm telling you this so you can start preparing my care plan and all my care cards and all that stuff. Because I have some real thoughts about this. I turn 62 next week. I can get Social Security, so I'm getting closer. So I could be there tomorrow. So I'm really working on this. So you're working on those strengths, you're working on those goals, and you're looking at, what are we doing for this person? Are we improving? Are we maintaining? What are we doing? Are we making them comfortable? Are we just giving them quality of life? The outer circle is really what you have begun to teach me. The outer circle being that relationship, the knowing the person, knowing them so well that you can predict or kind of know where those strengths and characteristics are. And then somebody else brought up the issue of the consistent assignment. Somebody's working with you all the time. They get to know the heart and soul of you. You know, I can remember back when I was probably 16, and I worked in my first nursing home. And there was Lucy. And, you know, we did those awful things where you use those restraints and you did all that stuff. But Lucy used to like to whack you when you did her care. Yes, yes. But you know what? Even as a kid, I learned that if Lucy and I sang through her morning care, and I can tell you I sang Daisy Daisy and I sang all those old songs that you could remember the words to, we'd get through every care cycle, at least with me, that I never got hit. But I was the weekend aide. So it's the little things like that, you know, you get from a consistent assignment. And again, making those decisions and the personal knowledge of bringing your resident to the table. And this is just the RAI, I'm not even gonna hit that. When you work on your care area assessments, and everybody does them a different way because there is no specific format, correct? The ones that CMS has given us have this statement on them. And to me, this is a very important part of the statement. The input from the resident, their family or representative regarding the care area. It's asking for information on how to address or what they think about the particular problem. Are you collecting that on every one of your care area assessments? Hello, is anybody out there? Am I by myself? Are you doing that? If not, you should be. Because that's a good way to be able to build and make the care plan. Because if this process, if this care area assessment, this is when you get to be the CSI guy, you know? You get to go digging, and you get to find all the information that'll help you make a blueprint care plan that means something. And if you have people who don't know the resident that are doing these, my only comment is shame on you, because you're doing a disservice to your elder, because it really is intended to be the person that's the closest to the elder to make these. We're going to do a little exercise. And I don't want you to look at your PowerPoint notes, because it'll, unless you just don't like to think at this time of the afternoon. If you prefer to, you can. But I want to pick your brain a little bit. I had left on your tables a case scenario regarding Fred Gladstone. And Mr. Gladstone, as we get working on him, is a very near and dear person to me, okay? And we're going to talk about Mr. Gladstone. I gave you a case scenario. That's what I really want you to take a look at first. If you didn't take a minute to read it ahead of time, I'll give you just a couple minutes because it's not a long one. So has everybody read it? No? Take a minute to look at it, and then we'll talk. Oh, sure. Yeah, they should have it as well, because it went out to... Oh, no, okay. Oh, no, that's right, I got one. For those folks, if you weren't aware, we are live streaming, so let me just give a little scenario here. Mr. Gladstone is an 89-year-old man. He was in World War II. He underwent cardiac bypass surgery, had 5 bypasses done. During the surgery, prior to his going into surgery, he was capable of doing for himself. He would make his own meals. He could drive. He was a pretty independent guy. He goes in for the surgery and has a stroke on the table, has a calcium spray deposit that broke loose, which is what caused the stroke, and ends up with vascular dementia. Okay? So he comes into your nursing home. Basically, he is he's got weakness on one side. When he first had the stroke, he couldn't sit up. He was he's forgetful, doesn't remember, you know, kind of who people are always. He's still kind of good with time. Time and where he is, but that can fluctuate. He doesn't remember what his impairments are. Okay? He still thinks he can hop out of bed and run to the bathroom like he's always done. He's also becoming more tearful. He has very active family. His son had just gone back home to an out of state. His daughter is very actively involved. She's the healthcare proxy. He has started to show more of an increase in irritability, and he's been more tearful, bitey with the staff, less cooperative. He is been showing some incontinence, more bladder than bowel. He is declining in his appetite. He's got a weight loss, and has stopped being as social, because he used to go to the dining room and didn't mind, but now he's saying he doesn't like his table mate, so he doesn't want to go. And let's see, what else? He's a smoker, likes a beer. He has a history of high blood pressure. He's had a heart attack in the past. He's got glaucoma. He's non-insulin dependent diabetic. Got a major anxiety disorder, and he's on multiple medications. How's that? Okay? Does that kind of capture it for everybody? I want you to just look at these pictures for a minute. Sometimes we need to hear with our eyes, okay, as well as see with them. So just take a minute, and then I'm going to start moving through our case scenario, okay? And you have, if you've got the PowerPoint, you can look at the picture. But these pictures really tell a lot about this gentleman. So, what I want you to think about first is, what strengths did you see? And I need somebody right up here in the front. Would you help me? It's a simple thing. Just turn your paper over. And as people kind of give me some strengths, just keep track of them for me. Just kind of log them so I don't forget them. So what strengths did you see? Strong family relationship, okay? What else? Military. What does that mean? He's patriotic. Routines. What else? Sociable. Okay. I heard something else over here. Likes to be of service. Mm-hmm. He's independent. Yep, he had companionship with an animal. Anything else? He's a father. He's a grandfather. Yes. That's right. You got that from the summary, didn't you? Because that was one of his things. He's working on this photo project. Mm-hmm. What else? Anything? Either from the what you saw from the pictures or even the summary. Yes. He hasn't been sick. He's been a pretty healthy guy. Very social. Where was he social? Everywhere, didn't matter what. What do you see with this guy? You see anything in his face? Pride. What else? Happiness. Love. What else? Mm-hmm. Do you caring? Yep. See any twinkle in the eye? Think he might have liked to have fun? Mm-hmm. To me, people's faces say a lot when I talk to them. Oops. Anything else that we missed? So we got them all? My friend, what's your first name? Nelia. So I'm going to skip over these things for a minute, and I'm going to go to what are the strengths that I saw, and then we'll see if we missed any, based from the summary to the pictures. We talked about interested family. We talked about sociable. What about those leisure activities? Did we mention that? The photo project, yep. So he liked independent activities, but we kind of also, because of his sociability, we think he liked maybe some other ones, right? Huh? Walking his dog, maybe, yep. Was he motivated? In the paper, it talked about one of the things that was key to him is that he wants to get better. He wants to be needed. Do you think that's the key to people? Communicate needs. He was able to tell us. So if somebody can tell us, it makes it a lot easier than somebody, God forbid, that you've got that has dementia who can't. This makes your work even a little bit easier. He liked to have fun. He did have humor. Pets. Friends. He had a very strong religious faith. Really relied on that. Independence we talked about. He was a proud American. He had community supports and living arrangements. So if we got him better, he could have gone back home somewhere. So based on what you know about this gentleman, what is he going to trigger for from the MDS? And would somebody else, would you keep track of that for me? So he's going to trigger for being what? Is that one of our care area assessments? It is for the, so that's one of the titles of one of our costs. What is it? Psychosocial. Oh, okay, sorry, yep. You tired of running? I had one over here, hang on. You said psychosocial too? Okay, what else? Falls. What else? Incontinence. What else? Nutrition.
Mood state.
Mood state. Did I hear weight loss? Okay, weight loss. What else?
Communication.
Yeah, possible. Pressure ulcer. Say again. Oh, mobility. Yeah, would go under the what? ADLs. What else? Behavior? We said incontinence, I think, didn't we?
Yes.
Yeah. Anything else?
Cognitive impairment.
Psychotropic medications. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Activities? Vision?
Constipation.
Constipation. You think that's going to pop up? Is that one of your cause? Huh? But it would come under your med, probably, yeah. Skin, we said. We got them all? Possible. These are the things that he actually triggered for on the MDS. Okay? I think we got everyone but dental. We said visual, right? I actually missed weight loss, I think. I had nutrition, that's right. That's because it's under that, I'm sorry. Right. It may or may not. And depending on how those answers are on that MDS, it may not. That doesn't mean it might not be there, even though it didn't trigger. So, when you look at what's going on with this man in general, and we're building a care plan here, okay? This is where we're heading with this. Based on what you just read, or just came up with, what are the things from that list that you think will clinically link for this man? Do you follow what I'm asking you? What things go together that are probably going to be part of the problem that we're going to need to address for this man to help him get better? Well, yes, all of it. But what kind of goes together? All right, one at a time, though. I can't. I'm good, but my hearing's not.
Falls.
All right, he's falling because he's getting up because of what? Right, but what's happening now? He wants to go to the bathroom, but he doesn't know his limitation. And what's his limitation? He's got a weakness. Okay, so what else? So he's what? He's frustrated. Okay, how does that tie in? Oh, because maybe he's functionally incontinent because we don't get to him in time to get him to the toilet because he can't get up himself, so therefore he's getting up and he's trying to do it himself, then he's falling down, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. The limitation in mobility. Thinking about what you read and some of the issues that we talked about, what do you think is his primary problem? Think about that case scenario. What do you think is his major problem right now? He wants to be independent. And what's happening because he is now becoming more of a burden? He can't do it himself. Depression. So do you think maybe we have to get that under control to get his mood better, so then he's going to do what? He might participate more in therapy. Yeah, that's exactly where I was going. He might eat better, because right now he's losing weight, so he's probably weak too. Might, yeah. But maybe do you think we might want to find out maybe why he doesn't like to sit in that dining room? You know, I have to share this with you. I was just recently out doing some consulting. And of course, they had moved folks into the dining room. And they, and I mean, folks were really, really trying to do well. Don't get me wrong. But there was one resident who was very cognitively intact. The middle resident probably was kind of in and out. But the other person was very cognitively impaired and having trouble clearing their sputum. And all the time,
they're kind of coughing all over with the other residents. And then you wonder why they're not eating. We need to really stop and think about what we do sometimes. Is this making sense? Is it helpful? Okay, just check it. So we talked about the things that clinically link. So that if you're actually writing up this care plan, you could do one piece of this care plan that talked about the psychosocial, the mood, his nutrition and activities. Because we got to get that under wraps, right? And then another piece could be your psychotropic drugs and looking at the other pieces. When you talk about the cause, you have to address every single cause, but you don't have to care plan it if it's not a problem. Okay, so remember that. And I need my surveyor's help here. I would appreciate your feedback. I'm going to give you an example of what I'm talking about. I had a resident who was, I took care of mainly males, so I'm going to apologize to the males in the room because I usually use male examples. Not intentionally, it's because I took care of veterans. My friend John had lost his teeth probably 20, 25 years ago. But he could chew a steak. And he could take corn off the cob like anybody I know. He could eat better than I. He never choked. His gums were hard enough that he could chew. Would he have triggered on his MDS for dental? Of course he would have. He went to the dentist. We asked him if he'd wanted us to do anything as far as his teeth. But, you know, let's be reasonable here. His jawline was, you know, too shrunk by that point. And he just looked at me and said, "Honey, I appreciate you offering me teeth, but I don't need them." And he was right, he really did. So, would I have proceeded with care planning because he went to the dentist said no problems, he had all those things that we looked at? Yes, would we watch him for choking maybe down the road if something changed? Absolutely. But would it have been considered an active problem right now that I would have needed to care plan? No. I don't know how many care plans I pick up that I would have found that as an active problem. Because we don't always critically think through what we're doing. Okay. This is kind of when we write an interdisciplinary care note describing our care area assessments, there's some specific things that you have to make sure you're writing to make sure you can build your care plan well. This is kind of just a shortened version of what you have on the table, okay, because I've already given you a full complete note that deals with Mr. Gladstone's psychosocial mood and activities. But this one says basically that he was verbally abusive. We have to describe the problem. He's irritable, he's weepy, he's argumentative, all the things that we talked about, okay? And talks about his weight loss, so on and so forth. You really come up with the heart of what the problem is. Then we're going to pull in what's causing the problem. What's creating the issue and how is it impacting on his functioning? And, you know, we didn't bring up like the grieving, the loss of his memory recall, but we did talk about his independence. His son just went away and he probably doesn't know when he's going to see him again. So he's got all these issues that are causing this depression to get worse. Agreed? So then the third thing that we have to answer in this care area assessment is what are the risk factors? If we don't take care of this problem, what's going to happen to this guy? He's going to get more isolated. He's going to get more depressed. Do you think somebody in a nursing home could suicide? It does happen. You could have more weight loss. He could have a failure to thrive. So we got to break the cycle. And then the way that we're going to be looking at doing this is utilizing all those resources that are strengths for this man. Okay? So we've got family. What are the things that he previously enjoyed liking to do? Then, did somebody have a question? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so then we're going to look at why or why not our care plan is going to be made. And this just basically says that, you know, we've looked at everything, and because of what we found, we've got to get this under control first. And that's just the handout that I gave you. So let's talk about care plans and what's got to be in them. How are we doing for time back there? Okay. So we're looking at making sure we don't lose this guy. He's not going to decline more. Didn't we already talk about those strengths? That's why they need to be in there. Reflecting standards of professional practice, what does that mean? Does anybody know what that means? Because I see that as a deficiency every once in a while. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Got to stand up for me because I'm losing my... I'm sorry.
Airplane.
Yeah. Right, but what does... Right, but what does the piece that says the standards of current professional practice, that's what I was getting at, what does that actually mean, other than a surveyor? Right. So that, and what she said was, you know, the current practices based on discipline, is that a fair way of saying it? Dietary standards. What this really is saying is that nobody is your mama. You as a discipline, you as a nurse, dietitian, social worker, whatever you may be in your role, you have a responsibility to keep yourself current. And so that you need to be aware of changes in practice. Has anybody been in the hospital lately? It's the one that jumps out at me the most, because anybody, if you've had anybody in the hospital, do you know when the last time was they gave a bed bath? It's called a bath in a bag. But those are things that have changed. And it's been, you know, it's still research stuff. It's current practice. Some of us agree that it's right or wrong, probably based on how we were taught. But the point is, they're using, you know, best practices and those kind of things to make our care better. And that we have to be using those things and be knowledgeable of them. Measurable outcomes. Do you reevaluate your care plans? If you've done it for 6 months, 90 days, whatever it is, and you're not making a difference, don't you think you might want to change it? I've picked up care plans and they haven't changed in a year or more. It's scary to me. And if we have folks who have the right to refuse care, what are we doing? What are we offering to compromise? I mean, maybe it won't mean anything because maybe this is their belief. But we still have a responsibility to try. We have to educate. It's just like the diet liberalization. There's a lot of folks who aren't going to change their thoughts. And certainly looking at those objectives and outcomes of care. Can you give me a drink, please? Apologize for that. Talk too much, see? So we've talked about these things pretty much. Again, staff needing to know what those responsibilities are. If you know what's got to be in the care plan, they can be worked. Thank you very much. Oop, got it. So bottom line, when we're talking about these person-centered care plans. It's just that the resident's in control. And we're looking at honoring them, their choices. We've gone over that one. That's just kind of a repeat. When you're talking about your problems, is there a specific format that anybody's telling you how to write these care plans? Is there? No. Bottom line is, this is what has to be in them. You got a problem, actual or potential. You got, what's the problem related to? What are the things that you're seeing related to this person? If we've got somebody who gets agitated over something, you want to describe, what does that agitation mean on this care plan? So that if I read it, I know what it's talking about. And then you're pulling in strengths, what motivates. Let me give you an example of what I mean by that. I use myself. I'm a lifelong Weight Watchers member. I fall off, I go back on. Fall off, go back on. But when I go on, and I go on the scale, and I see the dip, hopefully in the downward slope, I get motivated to diet again better the next week. If I'm a resident, and you're working on something that I'm motivated to do, that's my goal, not your goal, do you think I might be more inclined to try to achieve it? Yeah. And do you think maybe it would be real important that we'd want to reevaluate it a little more often? I often tell folks when I'm teaching care plan classes, not everything gets fixed in 90 days, just because the MDS is due then. It might be important that it's a week or two, and you keep track of when it needs to be reviewed, and maybe only that piece gets re-reviewed. But if you're going to motivate them, give them that hope. Does that make sense? I forgot to tell you at the start, if I sound like a delusional person, you're allowed to tell me. This stuff means a lot to me. So the goal is the residents. The interventions, the things that you do, those are yours. And they are meant to help the elder achieve their goal. We've talked about all these things. I want to talk about the care plan. This is a care plan that we wrote for Mr. Gladstone. Is it a perfect care plan? No. And it's one that pretty much addresses the psychosocial piece. One of the things that I find, and it, you know, technology can be a wonderful thing, but you know, a lot of these EMR systems, they have these canned libraries that are coming up that, you know, everybody's pushing these buttons. Well, we're going to do this, and then we're going to do this intervention, this, blah, blah, blah. And it means nothing. My belief is that if you, say for an example, you had an old care plan book, and they used to put them in books in my day, and they were in binders that never snapped well, and the book would fall on the floor, and accidentally all the residents' names came off of that book, you should be able to pick up each individual care plan, read it, and know who you're talking about. Can you do that? Say, you're working on it? Most often I have my groups tell me it's usually the people who have behaviors, because they know who has the behaviors and they have special things, special behavior things that they're doing with them. We should be able to do that for everybody. In New York, we had done a grant called Exceptional Care Planning. And one of the things that we did in that particular grant was we used standards of care, which are perfectly all right. And even the regulation says that you can use standards. And you can pull out a lot of the clutter from your care plans if you have standards of practice or standards of care, so that you may refer to the standard, but then, let me use vision as an example so it makes sense. If you're talking about You know how we often put in there, we're going to clean the glasses, we're going to make sure that they're on, we're going to make sure that, you know, they see the ophthalmologist, so on and so forth, which would be the routine care of somebody with glasses, okay? Instead, you would put all that information in a standard of practice that everybody does for somebody who has eyeglasses. But then the care plan would say, see, standard for vision or eyeglasses, whatever you named it. But the care plan would say, Barb Bates, at bedtime, takes her glasses off, leaves them on the right side of her bed stand so that she could reach them. Or, if you have to wake Barb Bates during the middle of the night, put her glasses on before you provide care, which will prevent you from getting whacked because I can't see you. Does that make sense? Are you doing that? Is anybody working with standards right now? Pulling them out of the care plan, or out of the, a lot of that information out of care plans? Great. Okay.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it gives us all of those things that help us make very individualized care plans.
Yep.
Same thing with the food preferences. If you have somebody that's really sad, one of the questions is, what are your comfort foods?
Yep.
It helps us to, you know, if they're not eating well, those things that we can go to try and see if they will at least eat those things.
Yep, absolutely. So anyhow, I'm not going through each of these care plans. I gave them to you just as an example. Yes, what do we got, 10 minutes left? Okay, that gives us some time to talk. These were examples of some goals. Just wanted to bring those out to you so that you can see that Mr. Gladstone wanted to get better. He knows he's feeling sad. He's had an issue all his life. With anxiety, so we need to work on these things. And we need to work on them. And we better get them fixed before 90 days or he's going to keep losing more weight and all those things. So again, we're looking at those prime problems, and this is just a sample. I mean, there'd be more to his care plan than this. But, and there's any way you want to write them. And I've seen them written in, what do you call them, essay form? I've seen them written in, you know, the traditional, you know, problem goal approaches with an evaluation column. I mean, you could write them how you want them. As long as they have the keys to what the regulations say needs to be there, and it talks about the person as a whole. That's really what we're going after here. Yes? Program?
Program this morning.
Yep.
I wonder when is there a time that we'll be able, as Park Care Partners, to get beyond the idea of a problem and a goal and approach or an event intervention, and thinking about someone's well-being, so that shift of from problems to well-being, and identifying all the things that Mr. Gladstone, all those characteristics that we wish to support in him.
Yeah, and I think even now you could do that, but I think you still need to figure out a way to bring those things in that impact his wellness, you know? That you still look at those things that maybe are his strengths that we could work on to make even better yet, that he can rely on them versus focusing on all that negative stuff. We don't have to do it this way. It really could be written different. No, there's no format. Just do. Yeah. We've just done it this way since, well, I was in nursing school. I don't know about the rest of you, but. Did she write those, do you think? And again, that just, I put medicines on the back because I, as I said before, I'm a PRN cookie and milk lady. And I like alternative therapies a lot. I don't like seeing us push pills all the time. There is sometime a time and a place, but it's not all the time. things that I think can be tools for you. Yeah. And
could I ask one question from one of our online viewers regarding the care meetings? They asked if you recommend that at the end of a care plan meeting or shortly after, the family receive a written plan that they can follow, which summarizes the meeting.
You know, I don't know. Does anybody do that? I mean, I have homes that do. It's not required. I think it's useful. My want would be to have them included, but that isn't always possible. There's a lot of homes that will do a written summary in general of what exactly was discussed at the meeting so that it just kind of brings out everything that was talked about, and if the resident or the family isn't present, it often includes what is going to be the follow-up, and maybe that is the follow-up, that you do some kind of a review with them. Otherwise, some facilities actually copy the care plan and give it to the family members and the resident. Seen that done too. So it's really facility desire. You've got some really good tools that are out there. I know we hate doing those interviews that come with the MDSs, but they can be of benefit. And the other thing that I find that a lot of times we don't do is, for example, like your the PHQ-9 or the BIM scores. People don't look at them in the respect of what it means from last time. I mean, it says we're supposed to look at the previous and to see if there's a change from last MDS to this MDS. Often it's self-populated in our wonderful computer systems. But then when I go into the homes and say, who looks at that? Who knows, is there a change? And I have the team members looking at me like, what are you talking about? And I say, what does that mean? Well, if cognitively they got worse, do you think maybe the care plan might need to be changed? Hopefully you would have looked at it or found it before that, but do you think that might be necessary? Yeah. When our residents, they love us. They really do love us. And you go in and you ask these interviews, questions. A lot of times they're answering and they get very used to it because you walk in the door, it's blue, bad, sock, whatever those things are. But there's often times that they're giving us the answers that we want to hear because they know what they're doing. But if you're looking at faces, sometimes you need to pay attention. Does the face match the answer? Especially when you're doing things like the PHQ-9. Looking at cultural beliefs, that's a biggie to me. You know, we in the area where I come from, we have a lot of Native American folks. And they, you know, we've had the want of the medicine man or whatever they call them. I'm not good with culture always. But, you know, we have to work those needs in as well. Just a couple other quotes to end us up. I think about, again, folks who deal with listening and linguistics. Without credible communication, a lot of it, the hearts and minds of others are never captured. And that's from John P. Cotter. And to say that a person feels listened to means a lot more than just their ideas get heard. It's a sign of respect, and it makes people feel valued. I think that's really key. So, if you have any questions, glad to take them, no guaranteed answers. I hope this has been helpful to you. Any questions that we have? Yeah.
I would like to follow up on the issue that was raised over here about new ways to do care planning that would fit the language of Pioneer Network. And specifically, I would like to hear from the surveyors in the room, and would the new language be acceptable and the new thoughts be acceptable?
Any of you want to take that on?
Well, I think, first of all, We don't tell you how to write your care plans. We shouldn't be. How you write your care plans, we shouldn't be telling you how to do that. But probably one of the most important things that I caught that you were talking about is those changes. Those are the ones that are going to get you in trouble, those harm levels. If that person declines in ADLs or range of motion and pain, and you're not identifying what's causing that change or changing your care plan to address that change, then you're going to hit the harm levels, and
yes,
those are the bad ones. And you know, that's probably the best advice I can give you to avoid harm level deficiencies.
Yeah, one of the things that I see when I consult a lot is that people are not capturing acute changes real time. They're doing it after the fact, or you know, when they get a chance, kind of a thing. You need to be real time looking at what's going on with your folks. And you know, we're hoping to break the cycle of a problem before it becomes a long-standing issue, or you know, ends up as a hospitalization or whatever. And I see that we miss the boat on that quite a bit.
If I could throw in one online comment real quick that was relevant. Susan Crane had said, maybe it's time to move away from problem-oriented medical records and nursing diagnosis and look at needs instead of problems. And
yeah, we mentioned that previously, and I absolutely have, I certainly don't have a problem with that. I teach based on what the RAI manual and what kind of the regulations support, but there's lots of ways that you can do the same thing without you know, missing the boat and not, you know, more or less addressing the positive sides of wellness and that kind of thing. But you still have to monitor what's going on with the person. And it's when you don't do both, that's when it's going to bite you, you know where. Any other questions? I think we're just about out of time anyhow. Yes? No? My timekeeper left. Oh, no, she didn't. Are we out of time?
We're good.
We're good. You guys have been great, and I hope being interactive, it was helpful. And I'll be around if you have any questions. I have business cards if anybody wants any. I'm not selling anything, but boy, I sure will be willing to do anything you'd want me to do with care plans in your homes. Yep, you sure can. Let me just grab it, okay?
All right.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Barbara.
Uh-huh. Thank you.